After a barrage of Unreal Engine 5 releases over the past couple of months, we're finally free from that curse, if only for a while, because now we have Dying Light the Beast, the true sequel to the original Dying Light. Considering that this was originally planned as a DLC for Dying Light 2, it uses the same technology and looks visually similar to that game. At first glance, the game makes an excellent impression and it looks beautiful, even stunning at times. But as a title launching on old-gen consoles, it leans on older techniques, and the flaws become apparent upon closer inspection. The game seems to heavily rely on screen space global illumination, which does a decent job of simulating local and bounce lighting, especially outdoors. Indoors, however, it falls short, leaving many objects unshaded, which hurts the visual presentation. And I believe Dying Light the Beast will significantly benefit from the upcoming ray tracing implementation. That being said, even at its current stage, this isn't a bad-looking game at all. Now, when it comes to performance stability, as is often the case with games built on in-house engines rather than Unreal Engine 5, this game delivers stable performance with a flat frame time graph most of the time. However, the starting issues stem from poor implementation of certain features. NVIDIA Reflex in particular triggers noticeable stuttering, as you can see here. This issue becomes even more severe when using DLSS frame generation, which requires Reflex. Not only that, but if you enable Reflex and then try to disable it, you'll need to restart the entire game. Like here, since I am running the game at 120Hz with VSync, my FPS is capped at 120. With Reflex enabled, the FPS drops to 116, which is normal behavior. But after disabling Reflex, my FPS stayed at 116, meaning Reflex was still running despite being turned off. This also affects DLSS frame generation. Here I am getting around 72 FPS. Enabling DLSS frame generation worked as expected, boosting FPS to around 116. However, when disabling it, the game remained locked at the base performance it was using for frame generation, 58 FPS or exactly half of 116. And this does not affect FSR frame generation, which works as expected. So the implementation of both DLSS frame generation and Reflex is currently broken, and I don't recommend using either of these features. The game also seems to suffer from a VRAM leak when using high texture quality. Here at 1440p with balanced DLSS, you can see the VRAM usage on the 3060 Ti keeps climbing with high textures, and it doesn't stop until the full 8GB is filled. At that point, stuttering kicks in alongside higher system RAM usage. I have also noticed the same issue on the 4070 Super, but because it has more VRAM, it takes much longer to fill up. So if you have disabled Reflex and DLSS frame generation but are still seeing stuttering or big performance drops, switch to medium texture quality. This helps most on 8GB GPUs, but can also improve stability on higher VRAM cards. The graphics options on Dying Light the Beast are fairly limited, and the bigger issue is that most of them don't really provide any significant performance gains, as we'll explore shortly. But before that, let's start by looking at image quality and upscaling. The story here is similar to most other games. At 1440p with balanced mode, DLSS 4 offers the cleanest image overall, as expected, while FSR 3 produces the least stable result, even worse than TAAU. However, things get dicey with the rain or heavy particle effects on screen. In these conditions, all upscalers show clear stability problems, as you can see here when using quality mode. Even DLSS 4 struggles under these conditions due to its usual disocclusion artifacts, which we can see more clearly here on the leaves and some of the foliage. Dying Light the Beast comes with two renderers, the X11 and the X12. Since the game mostly relies on older techniques compatible with the X11, there isn't any noticeable visual difference between the two. When it comes to the upscalers, XeSS isn't supported on the X11 and DLSS does not function properly. The game still runs with DLSS enabled, but the image is frozen, as you can see here. Performance-wise, the X12 is much more efficient and delivers better, more stable performance than the X11. The CPU has to do more work on the X11, which negatively affects both stability and overall performance. This becomes especially clear when targeting higher frame rates, where the X11 stability drops significantly. Overall, I see no reason to use the X11 for this game. Most modern GPUs and CPUs will perform better with the X12. There is also an option to toggle asynchronous compute, which I recommend leaving enabled, as it should benefit most modern GPUs and deliver some free performance gains. Moving on to LOD quality, this one has a subtle visual impact as it primarily affects some trees and smaller details as you can see here. As a result, there is more trees and vegetation popping when using low, but it's not very significant. Performance-wise, the impact can reach up to 8% in certain scenes like this one. So generally, I recommend leaving this setting at high, but if popping doesn't bother you and you need the extra performance, switch to low. And in the same category, we have the draw distance multiplier. Unlike the previous setting, this one has a much bigger visual impact and affects more elements, including terrain, vegetation, and buildings. It's also by far the most demanding setting in the game. From a vintage point, 150 comes with a 19% performance cost, 200 with 32%, and 300 with a massive 45%. In normal gameplay though, the impact is less severe, around 7% for 150, 19% for 200, and 37% for 300. So for this one, I recommend keeping the slider between 130 and 150. After draw distance, most settings either don't have a significant visual or performance impact, or sometimes neither. Take particles quality for example, which doesn't seem to do much. I checked different effects like rain, as you can see here, or intense fire, and I couldn't spot any difference in visuals or performance between medium and high. So since this setting doesn't seem to have any visual impact, I'll keep it at medium, just in case it gives a bit of extra performance on some areas. Next we have shadow quality. This one primarily affects the detail and resolution of the game's shadow maps, though even on high, shadows aren't particularly stable. Performance-wise in this scene, there is a 3% drop when going from very low to medium and 5% when switching to high. Therefore, I recommend leaving shadow quality at low or medium. Moving on to screen space shadows, this setting has a major visual impact, as it adds extra shadows to elements that the shadow maps miss, like smaller objects and finer geometry, and it has a negligible performance impact, so I recommend keeping it enabled. Let's move on to ambient occlusion quality. This one controls the intensity of the game's ambient occlusion, but as you can see here, high is a bit overkill. It overshades the scene and creates a dark halo around most objects. Performance-wise, the impact is minimal, around 2% when going from none to high, so for this one I recommend medium. Next we have global illumination quality. As you can see, this setting has a very subtle visual difference, only noticeable when rapidly switching between low and high. Side by side, both options look identical and there is no noticeable performance impact, so I recommend leaving this one at high. Moving on to reflections quality, this one controls the accuracy of screen space reflections. As you can see here, medium and high capture more of the surrounding scene and reflections compared to low. Performance-wise, the impact is minimal, around 3% from low to high, so I recommend keeping this one at medium or high. Let's move on to fog quality. This one also has a small visual impact, noticeable only in foggy areas. Medium and high give the fog a more detailed look and color that slightly better reflects the surrounding environment. In terms of performance, there is a small hitch when using high, which doesn't provide any extra visual benefits over medium, so I recommend leaving this one at medium. Finally, we have post-process quality. This one tweaks certain post-processing effects, like the intensity of depth of field. Interestingly, it can also slightly affect the shading on some surfaces, as you can see here. Performance-wise, like many other settings in this game, it has a negligible impact, so you can safely leave it at high if you prefer the stronger depth of field effect. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for Dire Light the Beast. Now let's compare the optimized settings against the high preset and max settings at 1440p with DLSS4 balance and medium textures on all sides. As we have seen throughout the video, the game settings are extremely limited in scalability. Only the draw distance multiplier delivers meaningful performance gains. And we can see that here with about an 11% improvement when going from high preset to optimized settings. On the other hand, we can see a much larger gain, around 68% when going from max settings with 300 draw distance multiplier to optimized settings. So technically, the only real positive aspect of this game is its performance stability. Everything else falls short. Reflex and DLSS frame gen are broken and can disrupt stability. There is a potential VRAM leak when using high textures. The game's lighting doesn't hold up most of the time, and the promised ray tracing isn't here to save it. And despite relying on traditional mature rendering techniques, the game still doesn't perform as well as it should, in my opinion. In the end, Techland really needs to polish this game further, as they did with the previous Dying Light games. Before ending the video, I want to give a quick shout out to my Patreon. If you are able and would like to directly support my work, consider becoming a patron to get access to the highest possible quality of my latest videos, including this one. And a big thank you to all my supporters, and thanks to you as well for watching until the end. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.